Hello friends, in this lecture we will discuss design of rigid pavements as given in IRC 58/2015. A rigid pavement or a concrete pavement is made of cement concrete or reinforced concrete. IRC SP 83 categorizes rigid pavements into three types: jointed plain cement concrete, jointed reinforced concrete pavement, or continuously reinforced concrete pavement. In this lecture, we will discuss only jointed plain concrete pavements. The components of rigid pavements are subgrade, which is natural soil compacted at OMC and dry density. Above that, you have a base or subbase course, and above this, you have a slab of thickness H. These slabs are held together in the longitudinal direction through double bars to transfer the load of moving wheel from one slab to another, and in the transverse direction they are held together with the help of tie bars. The slabs have longitudinal joints as well as transverse joints. Now, this photograph shows you the tie bars as well as the dowel bars, and clearly you can see here these are the tie bars for longitudinal joints and these are the dowel bars to transfer the load from one slab to another slab. There is a separation layer, which is a PVC sheet, which is laid between the DLC and the concrete slab. The stresses in rigid pavements are mainly because of wheel load and temperature. The temperature can cause warping stresses, which is due to daily variation in the temperature, or it may be frictional stresses, which are due to seasonal variation of temperature. The wheel load stresses create fragile stress in the slab, and temperature stresses are due to the temperature differential between the top and bottom of the slab that can create a curling stress, which is similar to bending stress, and this is introduced at the bottom or top of the slab depending upon which part of the slab is hot. The frictional stresses occur because of contraction of the slab, which might occur due to shrinkage or due to drop in temperature, and that is also in the form of tensile stresses at the middle portion of the slab. IRC 58/2015 considered design of pavement considering frictional stress under the simultaneous action of wheel load and temperature gradient for different categories of the axles. And it takes into account the sum of cumulative fatigue damages caused by single, tandem, and tridem axle load applications due to tensile fracture stresses at the top and at the bottom of the slab. And a pavement is considered to have failed if sum of the cumulative damages is greater than one. If the cumulative fatigue damage because of bottom up cracking plus cumulative fatigue damage because of top down cracking is less than or equal to 1, then the pavement is considered to be safe from large scale cracking. There are several factors which govern the design of a concrete pavement. These include axle load characteristics, wheel base characteristics, design period, design lane, design traffic, temperature differential, subgrade characteristics, and concrete strength. When it comes to axle load characteristics, the legal axle load limits in India are 10.2 tons for single axle, 19 tons for tandem axle, and 24 tons for tridem axle. It is important to carry out axle load survey in field to get the overloading spectrum on the pavement, because the design of rigid pavement is based on cumulative fatigue analysis, and therefore concept of VDF is not applied here. And when we carry out axle load survey, the sample size that should be taken that depends upon the number of commercial vehicles per day. For more than 6,000, at least 10% should be weight. For 3,000 to 6,000, 15%, and for less than 3,000 CV per day, at least 20% of the sample size should be taken. As regards to wheel-based characteristics, a rigid pavement is analyzed for top-down cracking and as well as for bottom-up cracking. For top-down cracking, axles having spacing less than or equal to 4.5 meter are only considered, And this 4.5 meter is considered because this is the typical spacing between transverse joints. Axial with more than 4.5 meter are not considered in case of top-down cracking. And if the spacing of transverse joint is different from 4.5 meter, then design traffic should be taken appropriately. The design life, the concrete pavements are designed generally for 30 years, but the design period may change depending upon the factors like traffic volume, traffic growth rate, and capacity of the road and possibility of widening at later stage. Design lane, the lane carrying maximum number of heavy commercial vehicles is considered the design lane. And this will be each lane of a two-lane, two-way highway, and the outer lane of multi-lane highway is considered as design lane. Now, design traffic should be calculated based on average daily traffic counted for 7 days, 24 hours, as per guidelines given in IRC 9. As far as possible, growth rate should be estimated from past data, but IRC SP 84 suggests a minimum growth rate of 5%. Daytime is responsible for bottom-up cracking, and nighttime traffic leads to top-down cracking. Edge flexural strength for bottom-up cracking is maximum when tire imprint of outer wheel touches the longitudinal edge. When the tire print is away even by 150 mm from the longitudinal edge, the stress in the edge region is reduced substantially. Typical lateral distribution characteristics of wheel path of commercial vehicles observed on Indian highways indicate that very few wheels of vehicle are tangential to the longitudinal joints. And therefore, for bottom of fatigue damage, 25% of total two-way commercial traffic is considered as design traffic for two-lane, two-way roads. For four-lane and multi-lane divided highway, 25% of total traffic in the predominant direction is used for bottom-up cracking. For top-down cracking analysis, 50% of bottom-up cracking analysis is taken. And the front axles with the single wheel on either side will cause very little bottom of fatigue damage, and therefore they are generally not considered in the design. Design traffic is calculated as by normal equation given here. 365 into A, 1 plus R power N minus 1 upon R. R is the growth rate. A is the initial number of commercial vehicles per day in the year when the road is open to traffic. Another important design factor is temperature differential between the top and bottom fibers of the pavement, and that can cause the slab to curl, giving rise to stresses. The temperature gradient in a concrete slab depends upon several factors like longitudes and latitude of the area, and it must be estimated for the given situation. In the absence of local data, a table given in IRC 58 can be used to take the maximum temperature differential depending upon the area and the depth of the concrete slab. During daytime, temperature variation with depth is assumed to be non-linear, while during night, this is linear. And maximum temperature differential during the night is taken half of the daytime maximum temperature differential. Pavement temperature differential is positive when the top surface of the pavement slab is hotter than the bottom surface, and it happens during daytime, and this gradient is non-linear, creating bending or curling in the slab downward. That creates tensile stresses at the bottom, and this becomes in tension, this side of the slab becomes in tension, and crack may initiate at the bottom, and then they can propagate upward, and that is called bottom up cracking. During night time, there is a negative temperature differential which is taken as linear, and therefore the slab will take the concave shape curling upward, and tensile stress will develop at the top, and when the wheel comes on this pavement, then the tensile stress will be here and there will be a crack on the top of the slab and it will propagate downward. Another important consideration in temperature gradient is zero stress temperature gradient. Concrete pavements in India are generally laid during night hours due to high temperature during daytime, and therefore a slab laid during night will experience high positive temperature gradient during daytime. But despite of this high gradient, the slab remains flat during the hardening process because of its plastic stage. And during this condition, slab has no stress. And this temperature gradient, when there is no stress in the slab, is called zero stress temperature gradient. Now, research indicates that exposure of fresh concrete to sun during hardening process causes a permanent curl in the concrete pavement, and this curl is nearly equal to the curl caused by a negative temperature differential of 5 degrees centigrade. And therefore, when the maximum temperature differential during daytime is 20 degrees centigrade, then for the purpose of stress calculation, it can be taken as 15 degrees centigrade. However, this reduction is not made so that the design for bottom-up cracking is conservative. But during night hours, if the temperature is 10 degrees centigrade, then total effective negative temperature differential can be taken as 15 degrees centigrade. The maximum positive temperature differential is assumed to be constant for 6 hours during 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. And the maximum negative temperature differential is assumed to be constant for 6 hours from midnight to 6 a.m. in the morning. And the slab is assumed to be free of curling stresses for remaining 12 hours for the purpose of fatigue damage analysis. Another important consideration in the design is the strength of the subgrade. And in concrete pavement analysis, subgrade is considered as a weaker foundation, which is also known as dense liquid foundation. Here it is assumed that foundation is made up of springs supporting the pavement slab. The CVR of embankment soil placed below 500 mm subgrade should be determined for estimating the effective CVR of subgrade and its K value for the design. The strength of subgrade is expressed in terms of modulus of subgrade reaction, which is K, and it is determined by plate load test. And you can watch my another video on effective modulus of subgrade reaction. The IRC 58 suggests the relationship between K value and CBR for homogeneous soil subgrade, and you can choose the value of K for a given effective CBR of subgrade soil. If the CBR of 500 mm thick compacted subgrade is significantly larger than that of embankment below, the effective CBR of subgrade can be estimated from this figure. And this figure gives you the CBR value of 500 mm thick subgrade and CBR of soil below 500 mm thick subgrade, that is the CBR of embankment soil, and corresponding to these two values, you can find out what the effective subgrade CBR. Now, this procedure is similar to what I explained in the design of flexible pavement using IRC 37. A minimum CBR of 8% is recommended for the 500 mm thickness of subgrade soil, and the modulus of subgrade reaction of the subgrade for an in-service pavement or of a prepared foundation can be estimated by falling weight deflectometer. But we should remember that the value of K, which is determined from FWD data, is dynamic K value. And for design purpose, the static K value should be taken as 50% of dynamic K value. In the absence of FWD data, K value can be determined for different combinations of subgrade and subbase for treated and untreated from this table. Alternatively, you can watch my video for estimating the effective K value of subgrade reaction. Now, this table gives you K value of granular and cement treated subbase for different thicknesses of subbase layer. And this is the K value of subgrade soil. You can choose the value of effective K from this table. If dryland concrete is provided as subbase material, then depending upon thickness of the DLC layer, you can find out the K value of subgrade. The last factor in the list of design is the concrete strength. And flexure strength of concrete is required for the purpose of design of concrete pavement. The flexure strength can be estimated from the characteristic strength of the concrete, which is the 28 days cube strength. And what IRC code suggests that in no case this 28 days flexure strength of pavement quality concrete be less than 4.5 MPa. The default values of concrete which are given in the code are models of elasticity of concrete, E value, that is 30,000 MPa, Poisson ratio can be taken 0.15, coefficient of thermal expansion 10 to the power minus 5 per degree centigrade, and flexure factor to obtain 90 day strength is 1.10. 90 days flexure strength is recommended in the design. The interface layer between the concrete slab and the dryland concrete layer can be made smooth to reduce the interlayer friction. And for this purpose, a debonding layer of polythene sheet having a minimum thickness of 125 micron is recommended. Alternatively, wax-based compound can also be used, or a layer of bituminous concrete with grading 2 can be another option for this purpose. There are two critical conditions which are to be considered in the design of concrete slab. One is bottom-up cracking and another one is top-down cracking. Now, bottom-up cracking occurs during daytime when the temperature gradient is positive and the slab takes the shape of the curve like this, and the wheel load is at the center of the slab. Now this gives the critical condition of flexure stress, and the stress at the bottom fiber of the concrete slab is maximum, and that can trigger a crack at the bottom and it will propagate upward. And this procedure is called bottom up cracking. Location of points of maximum flexure stress at the bottom of slab without tied concrete shoulder for single, tandem and tridem axial is shown in these figures. The tire imprints are tangential to the pavement edge, and the spacing between individual axles for tandem and tridem axles vary from 1.3 meter to 1.4 meter. And practically, there is no difference in stresses for axle spacing of 1.3 meter or 1.4 meter. And therefore, a spacing of 1.3 meter between individual axle has been used in the guidelines. During night hours, the top surface is cooler than the bottom surface, and the slab will curl upward in a concave shape. The self weight of the slab and the resistance provided by the double bar will create tensile stress at the top of the slab. The axle load, which is placed to the close to the transverse joints during night period, will further increase the flexure strength in the top layer, leading to a situation of top down cracking. The position of axles of different configurations on the slab with successive axles should be like this for top-down cracking to occur. The axles should be very close to transverse joint. In case of single axle, double axle or tridem axles, the IIT rigid software based on Pickett and Ray is used for stress computation in infinite slabs. And for bottom-up cracking, The single axle load causes the largest edge stresses, followed by tandem and tridem axles. Stresses due to tridem axles are very small and therefore they are ignored in bottom-up cracking analysis. And front axle weight has been assumed to be 50% of the weight of one axle of the rear axle unit for single, tandem or tridem for the purpose of analysis. The finite element analysis results have been used to develop regression equations for estimation of flexural tensile stress for BUC as well as for TDC analysis. And several charts are developed for BUC analysis. And for TDC, for top-down cracking analysis, the regression equations are suggested in IRC code. This is just one chart with the axle load of single axle load of 80 kN and temperature gradient of 0 degree centigrade without any concrete shoulder and for different values of K. Likewise, there are 111 charts in IRC code depending upon varying temperature, axle load, type of axle, and with or without concrete shoulders. Similarly, the regression equations for top-down cracking are developed like this. This is just one example, and likewise, there are 13 such equations given in the guidelines for single, tandem, axle, with or without tied concrete shoulder. The design is based on cumulative fatigue damage analysis of concrete slab due to wheel loads of different magnitudes and also temperature gradient. The pavement is checked for cumulative bottom-up and top-down fatigue damages. For bottom-up cracking, flexural stress at the edge due to combined action of single or tandem rear axle load and positive temperature gradient is considered. And for top-down cracking, it is negative temperature differential plus stresses caused by axle loads. This flexural stress is divided by the design flexural strength, that is modulus of rupture of concrete, to obtain the stress ratio. And this stress ratio is related with number of cycles to failure. As I told you earlier, BUC is considered when temperature gradient is positive, and it occurs during 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. daytime, and therefore cumulative fatigue damage for bottom-up cracking is considered for traffic from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. and this is the cumulative damage. Similarly, cumulative fatigue damage for top-down cracking is considered for the time period from midnight to 6 a.m. in the morning. The design criteria for rigid pavement is that the sum of cumulative fatigue damages should be less than or equal to 1. Now, this fatigue damage due to wheel load and curling stress at the bottom and the fatigue damage due to wheel load and curling stress at the top, the sum should be less than 1. Then the pavement is safe. In other words, if CFD of bottom-up cracking case plus CFD for top-down cracking case is less than or equal to 1, the design is safe. Otherwise, we have to change the thickness of the slab. So, in brief, the design steps which are to be considered for design of a concrete pavement, the step 1 is that you stipulate design values for various parameters, then select a trial design thickness of pavement slab, compute repeated number of axle loads of different magnitudes and different categories during the design life, and find proportions of axle load repetitions operating during day and night period. And from this, you estimate axle load repetitions in a 6-hour day period, and maximum temperature differential is assumed to remain constant for BUC. Estimate axle load repetitions in the 6-hour day period, and maximum temperature differential for TDC is half of BUC. It should be remembered that only those vehicles with a spacing between front and first rear axle less than the transverse joint spacing are considered for top-down cracking. And this I have explained earlier also. Step 7 is that compute the flexural stresses at the edge due to single and tandem axle load for combined effect of axle load and positive temperature gradient. Determine the stress ratio and evaluate the CFD for single and tandem axle loads. Compute the maximum flexural stress in the top surface of the pavement with front axle near transverse joint and rear axle near the following joint. That means the two axles should be close to the joints. And step 10 is determine the stress ratio and evaluate CFD for different axles for top-down cracking. Add up the CFD of BUC and TDC, and if the sum is less than 1, the pavement is safe against fatigue cracking. If it is more than 1, then increase the pavement thickness. Now let me explain this procedure, complete procedure, with one example. And then the example is like this. A cement concrete pavement is to be designed for a 4-lane divided national highway with 2 lanes in each direction in the state of Bihar. Now this is required for finding the temperature gradient. Design the pavement for a period of 30 years. Lane width 3.5 meter, transverse joint is spacing 4.5 meter. It is expected that the road will carry in the year of completion of construction about 3,000 commercial vehicles per day in each direction. Axle load survey of commercial vehicles indicated that front single axle is 45%, rear single axle 15%, rear tandem axle 25%, and rear tridem axle 15%. And 55% commercial vehicles have spacing between their front axle and the first rear axle less than 4.5 meter. This is the transverse joint spacing. Traffic count indicate that 60% of commercial vehicles travel during night hours, that is from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. And details of axle load spectrum of rear, single, tandem, and tridem axles are given in the Excel sheet. The front axles are not included here. The average number of axles per commercial vehicle is 2.35. It is more than 1 because of tridem axles. And effective CBR of compacted subgrade is taken as 8%. This is the axle load spectrum for single axle, tandem axle, and tridem axle. The class interval for single axle generally taken at 10 kN, for tandem axle 20 kN, and for tridem axle 30 kN. And this is a frequency in percentage, total be 100. Now this is to be used for cumulative fatigue damage analysis. So the first step in the design is selection of modulus subgrade reaction. The effective CBR of compacted subgrade is given 8%, and from this table you can interpolate the value of K between 7 and 10, and you get a value of 50.3 MPa per meter. Let us provide 15 millimeter thick granular subbase, and above that, a DLC layer of 150 millimeter thickness with minimum 7-day compressive strength of 7 MPa. That is the minimum strength required for DLC. And therefore, effective modulus of subgrade reaction of combined foundation of subgrade plus granular base and DLC subbase is from this table. For a 50.3 megapascal per minute and a layer thickness of 150 millimeter of DLC, you can interpolate between these and it will be 285 MPa per meter. Provide a debonding layer of polyethylene sheet of 125 micron thickness between DLC and concrete slab for smooth surfacing, and the concrete to be used is of M40 grade with 90 days of flexural strength of cement concrete 4.95 MPa. Now we estimate the design traffic for fatigue analysis. Design period given in the question is 30 years. Annual rate of growth, let us assume 0.075 or 7.5%. The commercial vehicle per day in each direction is given, 3,000 commercial vehicles per day. And therefore, total two-way commercial vehicles during design period will be 365 into A, 1 plus R power N divided by R. So it is 226 million for 44,692 commercial vehicles. Now, average number of axle per commercial vehicle given is 2.35. Total two-way axle load repetitions during the design period will be this value multiplied by 2.35, that is 532 million axles. And the number of axles in predominant direction, here we assume it is equal in both directions, and therefore half of this will be the number of excels in one direction, 266 million. Design traffic after adjusting for lateral placement of axles, which is taken as 25% of predominant direction traffic, that is 66,518,128 axles. The night time, that is 12-hour design axle repetition, is given as 60% in the question. Total traffic count indicates that 60% of commercial vehicle travel during night hours. This is the question. So 60% of this design traffic will be 39,910,877. Daytime 12 hour will be remaining 40% of this value, that is 26 million. Now daytime 6 hour axle load repetition will be half of this 12 hour repetition, that is half of 26 million, 13,303,626. That is the design traffic for bottom up cracking. Similarly, night time 12 hour design axle repetitions are 39 million, and half of that will be 6 hour load repetitions, that is 39 million multiplied by 0.5, that is 19,955,739. And the percent of commercial vehicles having the spacing between the front axle and the first axle of the rear axle unit less than 4.5 meter is 55%. It is given in the question. 55% commercial vehicles have spacing between their front axle and the first rear axle less than 4.5 meter. That is the spacing between transverse joints. Therefore, the 6 hour nighttime design axle load repetitions for top down cracking will be the design, this 19,955,439 multiplied by 0.55, that is this value, 10,975,491. So we have the design traffic for bottom of cracking analysis 13 million, and for top down cracking 10,975,491. Now this can be distributed according to axle load category. The front single axle load is 45%, rear single 15%, tandem 25%, and tridem 15% given in the question. And therefore you can distribute this total traffic for bottom up cracking 13 million to different categories, and similarly for top down cracking. So this is the design traffic for cumulative fatigue damage analysis. Now we assume some parameters for cumulative fatigue damage analysis. Effective modulus of subgrade reaction of foundation we have estimated for 285 MPa per meter. Elastic modulus of concrete for M40 concrete, it is 30,000 MPa. Poisson ratio of concrete is taken 0.15, unit weight 24 kN per meter cube. And design strength 4.95 MPa, and for the state of Bihar, maximum daytime temperature differential in slab is assumed to be 16.8 degrees centigrade. Now with these parameters, the cumulative fatigue damage analysis is better done in Excel sheet, and therefore we now move to Excel sheet. This is the Excel sheet which is used to analyze the pavement. Here in this part of the Excel sheet, you have all input data, like the carriageway, four lane divided road, transverse joint spacing 4.5 meter, lane width 3.5 meter, design period 30 years, number of commercial vehicles 6,000, growth rate, and so on. And these are the cumulative number of commercial vehicles which we calculated earlier. And the information, the figures of interest are these, that axle repetition for bottom up cracking, axle repetition for top down cracking for different types of axles, and these informations are given here. For top down, for bottom up cracking analysis, you have front single axle same value as we calculated here, and for top down cracking these values are from taken from the this table. Second part of this Excel sheet is axle load spectrum data, which are also given in the question. These data are used for bottom up cracking and top-down cracking. For bottom-up cracking, you have rear axle, rear single axle, that is expected number of repetitions. Flexural stress, now this value is calculated using the charts and equations given in the IRC code. And this is divided by the flexural stress of the concrete, that is 4.95, that gives you the stress ratio. And corresponding to this stress ratio, you find out what is the allowable repetitions. And this gives you the fatigue damage. So sum of all these values is 0.976. Now this is for a assumed thickness of the pavement. Here I will show you this part that we have assumed initially the pavement thickness to be trial concrete slab thickness is 28 centimeter. Okay, so for 28 centimeter thickness, the fatigue analysis for bottom up cracking is coming 0.976 for single axle. Similarly, for fatigue damage from tandem axle is zero because this stress ratio is less than 0.45. And if this value is less than 0.45, the allowable repetition will be infinite. So there is no fatigue damage. For bottom of fatigue damage due to single and tandem axle load is 0.976 plus 0, that is 0.976. For bottom of cracking, I told you we do not consider tridem axles. Similar analysis is done for top-down cracking, but here we consider all three rear single axles, rear tandem axles, and rear tridem axles. We calculate the fatigue damage and then take sum of all these three. So for single axle, it is 0.274, for tandem axle, 0.445, and for rear tridem axle, it is 0.036. So total of these three is 0.755. Now, since the summation of these two values, the total damage because of bottom up cracking, that was 0.976, and for top-down cracking, that is 0.755, is more than 1. Therefore, this design is not safe. So what we do now, we will change the thickness of the slab. Initially, we assumed 28 centimeter. Let us make it 29 centimeter. So here, in this sheet, if you assume the thickness to be 28, this is this thickness. If you change this thickness, trial thickness of concrete slab as 0.29, then all calculations will automatically change and it will give you the sum of CFD for BUC and TDC 0.533. For bottom up fatigue damage, it is now 0.281, and for top-down cracking, it is 0.252, and therefore sum is less than 1. So design is now safe. So it is 0.29 meter. So the design thickness of the slab is 290 millimeter. And if you consider two retexturing in 30 years, a thickness of 300 millimeter will be appropriate. So the final design is that on a subgrade of CBR 8%, provide 150 millimeter thick granular subbase. Above that, a DLC of 150 millimeter with a minimum 7-day compressive strength of 7 MPa, a debonding layer of polyethylene sheet of 125 micron, and a concrete slab of 300 millimeter. Next is the joints. There are four types of joints in cement concrete pavements. The contraction joints are transverse joint which relieve the tensile stresses in concrete pavements. The joint spacing is limited to 4.5 meter to prevent top-down cracking during night. Construction joints should, as far as possible, be placed at the location of contraction joint, except in case of emergency, where a key joint may be used. Expansion joints are also transverse joints to allow expansion of concrete slab due to rise in average temperature in summers. But these are no longer in use except near permanent structures like bridges and culverts, which may be damaged by the thrust of the expanding concrete slab due to rise in temperature. And the longitudinal joints are required in pavements of width greater than 4.5 meter to allow for transverse contraction and warping. The design of double bars and tie bars is discussed in another video, and similarly, the design of drainage layer is also discussed in a separate video. So friends, thank you very much for watching this video. You can write your comment in the comment box and give your observations.